The Twilight Zone was a TV series that ran from 1959 to 1964. Telling tales of disturbing or unusual stories, the series leaned towards fantasy, horror, science fiction, and mystery. In the same vein, the series spawned a film, 1983's Twilight Zone the Movie. What makes this movie particularly interesting is the real-life horror that occurred during its filming. Ironically, the unintended events that unfolded on set would seem right at home on the pages of a Twilight Zone script, resulting in the deaths of three people and the first time a film director faced criminal charges for events that occurred while making a movie. Produced by Steven Spielberg and John Landis, Twilight Zone the movie was split into four segments, each telling a separate story, largely based on episodes from the original TV series. Each segment would be directed by a different director, with Spielberg and Landis directing their own segments. The first segment was directed by John Landis and features the main character, played by actor Vic Morrow, traveling through time to the Vietnam War. A climactic sequence towards the end of the segment sees Morrow protecting two Vietnamese children as the trio are pursued by attacking American soldiers. The scene would be shot at night, following Morrow's escape from a village and across a shallow river with a child under each arm. Special effects such as pyrotechnics and explosives would see heavy use, and a helicopter would hover above, giving the impression the characters are fleeing an armed assault. Filming in 1982 in California, USA, director and producer John Landis was looking for two children of Asian descent to fill the roles of the Vietnamese children Morrow would have to protect. 6-year-old Renee Chen and 7-year-old Micah Lee were employed to this end. However, in doing so, Landis had violated California's child labor laws. The children were paid under the table as Landis had not acquired the necessary permits. It's believed the permits would have been very hard to obtain for the hours the children were working, as well as the fact they would be in close proximity to a large number of explosives and a real helicopter, a fact that was kept hidden from their parents. Many on set felt the special effects were starting to become a risk. The pyrotechnics were intense, the helicopter was flying low, and generally everything was very close together. Landis' attitude on set was described as dictatorial, and he shrugged off complaints and concerns in the aggressive pursuit of an epic scene. During the night of the 23rd of July 1982, the filming of that scene commenced. 53-year-old Morrow begins carrying Chen and Lee under arm. Pilot Dorsey Wingo brings his Huey helicopter into position. The pyrotechnics are set off. Micah Lee's father, who had survived the Vietnam War, was immediately startled by the explosions. The set brought back memories of the war, and sensing danger, he fell to the ground terrified. But he wasn't the only one apprehensive about what was going on. Pilot Dorsey Wingo was a veteran of the Vietnam War, and he felt the sparks and fireballs of the special effects were too close to his helicopter. Landis shouted for him to get closer to the action, as the helicopter navigated its way through explosions just 25 feet from the ground. By then, the craft was pelted with more detonations, damaging the helicopter and sending it out of control. Just below, Vic Morrow is running through the waist-high water with Chen and Lee. As the blasts go off all around him, Morrow loses his grip on Chen and she falls into the water. Morrow reaches out for her, but the helicopter slams into the water beside them. Chen is crushed as the rotor blades slice into Morrow and Lee. All three are killed instantly. 6 others are injured. As the accident had occurred on the last day of filming, the filmmakers were able to finish the movie with the material they already had, and in 1983, Twilight Zone the movie was released, albeit with the original Vietnam sequence removed. What followed was years of legal action. The families of the three victims filed lawsuits against the producers and the studio that settled out of court. In 1986, Landis, Wingo, a production manager, an explosive specialist, and an associate producer were all put on trial for manslaughter. Despite openly admitting to breaking numerous labour laws, the defence argued that the accident was just that, an accident, while the prosecution argued the tragedy had been caused by reckless attitudes and a failure to prioritise safety on set. In 1987, a jury acquitted all defendants. Since then, Hollywood has ushered in stricter standards for safety on movie sets. Today, insurance companies and risk management agencies keep a close eye and tight control over what happens on set. Of course, this does not completely eradicate the threat of accidents, and occasionally the public is reminded of this when an elaborate scene goes awry and kills or injures a stunt actor. But the accident in 1982 was of such a magnitude that it endangered every person on that set. What happened can only be described as total chaos, and it would not be surprising if the actors were experiencing genuine fear during the filming. As the set went out of control, did they realize that the danger was genuine too? Did the havoc bring terrified movie characters into reality, possessing the bodies of real human beings about to have their lives taken on screen? We can only hope that they were unaware in their last moments.